Thanks, Dave. I am so grateful for him and for his leadership. You know, even as our congregation, we celebrate, we turn 13 today. You'll hear about that a little bit later today as we take a group picture. Our very first baptism service, do you know who the very first person baptized was? Linda was first and Dave went second. That's right. But both have become just world-class leaders, and we're so proud of them. So, want to ask you, I told a little bit of some of my stories growing up last week, and we'll tell a little bit more about that today. Who here grew up where Sunday school was part of your life? So your grandma, your grandpa, your mom, your dad, somebody brought you to church somewhere. Yeah. All right. Okay. So, and if you didn't, no shame in that. But growing up, I remember in Sunday school as a little boy, we learned about God the Father. God the Father created all sorts of things like monkeys and fish and dogs and cats and Adam and Eve and really, really well-placed foliage around Adam and Eve, which I thought, you know, if we hadn't done so much with the foliage, it would have been much more interesting in Sunday school. But I learned a lot about God the Father, the Creator, and I learned about Jesus the Son. Last week I talked about flannel graph Jesus, the Jesus who shows up in stories to share the important message with everybody. Be nice. Be nice. And how, as I matured in my faith, and I'm so grateful that somebody invited me to a church youth group, in this case to a winter youth rally. It was there that I heard about a Jesus that wanted to know me and began a personal relationship and walk with Jesus at age 13. But it does occur to me that in both Sunday school and then even in my earliest Christian years, I heard about God the Father. He's the Creator, right? He's the Son, who's a flannel graph Jesus and sometimes buddy-buddy Jesus, and starting to learn that he was much more than all of those things. But I didn't hear very much about the Holy Spirit, this other person of God or aspect of God, although he did show up in the song, because we would always sing the song. Praise Father, Son, and Holy... Help me out. Ghost... Amen. Oh, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. So apparently there was some part of God that nobody really wanted to talk about, like my Uncle Lloyd. We knew he was in the family, but he never came to any of the dinners. We didn't really mention any of him. He was just sort of like this, where was he? Who was he? I didn't hear much about him until at age 16, there was a youth group across town. And maybe this is why I love musicals so much. They were putting on a musical, and they invited all the other youth groups in town that wanted to come to be a part of this, because they were getting ready to do their own winter youth rally, and so invitation went out to all these other youth groups and churches, and apparently I was the only one that showed up. But this was a Pentecostal church. And who here is raised Pentecostal? Lift them. Come on, you know how to lift them. Let's... What? There we go. That's right. Loud and proud, man. The music was awesome. Like this was something that just started to change my life. Because, see, growing up, church, we'd have the formal songs, you know, that you sing there because they're serious, man. You sing those songs serious. And we had the other songs that we would sing in church. You know, somebody would play the piano and really well-intentioned leaders, and they would wave their arms. We got to get this song over with. So we're going to sing song number 43, Do It. And as a young guy who just really loved music, this the fact that people were like into the music, like this was great. Plus, there was a really cute girl there. It's amazing how the Spirit can lead through those things. I married that girl. That was a good musical. That was a good musical. And it was a great experience. But my first encounters there were, here's a church that's talking about the Holy Spirit quite a bit. And my very first impressions of how this was experienced is I started to understand why the other churches didn't talk about the Holy Spirit so much. It's because there was some parts of it that at least is what I encountered there, they were a little off-putting. They were a little weird. Like, this is the Holy Spirit that makes people shake and makes people say funny things and all this stuff's going on. And that was both strange and, to be quite honest, it was very compelling. Here's some people that have just connected emotionally with God. Now, I don't know what your experiences were about hearing about the Holy Spirit for all those of you who raised your hands with being in Sunday school or even if you were raised in the Pentecostal church, and God bless you if you were. I mean, I grew so much from those experiences and from those encounters. For all of us, whether we hardly heard about the Holy Spirit at all or we heard about the Holy Spirit like all the time, as we come to really get into God's word unfiltered in the way that we're challenging each other to do, I mean, because we have set the highest discipleship bar in the season in our church that we've ever had. We are encouraging, challenging, helping each other along to read the entire New Testament in 40 days. Yeah. And if you've fallen a little bit behind, it's okay. Just read what you can, But here's the thing that we're discovering, and I keep hearing this again and again and again and again in the various connection groups as people are opening up God's word for themselves and starting to, the first challenge is reading it, the second challenge is talking about it. As I hear people talking about it, is people realizing that the boxes they had for who Jesus was or who the Holy Spirit was are getting greatly expanded. Jesus doesn't fit in your box very well. The real Jesus of the scriptures is wild and amazing and absolutely real and powerful and sometimes uncontrollable and sometimes hard to predict. And as we were reading last week, many of you were in the book of Acts. And if you did all the reading, you read all of Acts and you read 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, the Holy Spirit factors huge in that book. And I wanted to talk about two shifts that happened in the church as a result of the Holy Spirit. You probably picked up on these, but I think it might be helpful to highlight it. So we're going to actually read the first part of Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. And just because we love God's word, I invite you to stand. In this case, I'm just going to read it because there's some funny words in there, and I figured I shouldn't inflict that on somebody else. So you're welcome on that. But would you stand if you're able? If you're not able to stand, that's okay. I know you love God's word. But this is the story of the Holy Spirit being given to the church at Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt and parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors to Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs. We hear them declaring the wonders of God in their own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said they had too much wine. So please have a seat. But I want you to imagine this scene, okay? There's about 120 believers. Now, these are people that have already seen the resurrection. They've seen Jesus. They are convinced in their heads that Jesus is exactly who he says he is. They are convinced in their heads that Jesus is absolutely unique. And Jesus, just before he ascended into heaven, he told them, wait, 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 wait for the gift of the Holy Spirit. And here on this day, 120 believers are in a place somewhere, probably somewhere close to the temple. It's about 48 days after the death of Jesus. It's 50 days after Passover. That's why they called it Pentecost. 50 days. And something really remarkable happened. Just imagine that with me. So a wind starts to blow. Can somebody make some wind sounds? Help me out. And some, I don't know what the tongues of fire would look like, but just imagine that. Look around and imagine, like, what if the people around you were kind of glowing or something? I don't know. And then they heard something really remarkable. So here's all these people. They were Aramaic speaking, or if it was us today, it'd be much of us English speaking, and suddenly they hear these things they hadn't heard before. Gloria a Dios! And somebody understands what that means, and they shout it back to the preacher. Oh, come on. Okay, let's have a little bit of church today. Gloria a Dios.
Gloria a Dios.
Or maybe they heard something like gloire à Dieu. And the French person walking by went, woo, right? Ron Yao Ki Ke Shen. Say that with me. Ron Yao Ki Ke Shen. And the Chinese brothers and sisters went, whoa. Whoa, what is happening over there? If you know a language other than English, shout out something that it relates to glory to God. Just shout it out. Come on, my Spanish brethren, let's do this. There, gloria a Dios. Yes. Or maybe, amar como Cristo, that's our motto. Say that with me. Amar como Cristo. We love like Jesus. People were shouting out the praises of God in a multiplicity of languages. And here, 120 people, almost, well, it seems, very quickly gathered a crowd of thousands. They were so excited about that. Hank, what's he saying over there? He's jumping up and down saying, Gloria a Dios. And over there, there's Margaret, and she's in glory, Gloria a Dios. All this amazing stuff is happening. Everybody is gathering around. And Peter, and here's where we also know the Holy Spirit's been landing. Because you know, the Holy Spirit, and he shows up in power, he most of the time, it's not to make your life easier. It's to make your character stronger. Do you know that? When you ask God for help, it's not asking him to make your way easier. You're asking him to make you stronger, make you bolder, make you less afraid. And the Holy Spirit has landed on Peter. And the same person who has denied Jesus, who ran away because a servant girl said, oh, you look like you were with him, stands in front of a crowd of thousands and explains what's happening. We're going to keep reading here. So Peter began to speak. Now, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on who? All people, on all people. Check this out. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servant, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. Shift number one that happens with the arrival of the Holy Spirit is the Holy Spirit is given to all who follow Jesus. Say with me, power to the people. You know, because in the Old Testament, you might have picked up on this. You've got one or two great leaders. Here's Moses or Deborah. And so these leaders and prophets. And, you know, and for a season, they are filled with the Spirit. And they lead in powerful, bold, inspiring ways. But here, it's a different thing, isn't it? The Holy Spirit is poured out on the entire church. Men, women, young, old. You hear the barriers breaking down? All the little things of the gender roles, socioeconomic roles, age roles. You are never too old to be used by God, and you are never too young to be used by God. In fact, all of us have a role to play. After all, the young men will see visions, the old men will dream dreams. We need each other. Power is given to the people, The Holy Spirit lands on the group corporately. It also reminds us that if we really want the fullness of the Spirit in our life, we need others in our life. Now, you and Jesus are an unstoppable team. But if you want all of God in your life, you need the other gifts of the Spirit. You need each other. Poke your neighbor, you know? Give them a little elbow if you can. You need them. They have elements of the gifting of God that on your own you don't have. So we need each other. The Holy Spirit is given to the church. And then we see these really remarkable things happen. We're in the stories of Jesus. Here's Jesus is healing all these people. But then what starts to happen? You've read Acts, you know. All these believers everywhere start doing some of the same things that Jesus was doing. Whether that's teaching with boldness, or at times even, these miraculous things happening through the church. Power to the people. That's shift number one. That's shift number one. Now, even in that Pentecost story, we also saw the first part of shift number two, and it took the early church a long time to figure this out. Actually, much of Acts is they're wrestling with this. But the big moment happened a few chapters later, Acts chapter 10. Again, here's Peter. So Peter has, he's been praying, and maybe if you remember that story of where he sees this vision of a sheet that's descended and all this food coming down, and him hearing a voice saying, Peter, kill and eat. In other words, all these animals, you can eat them now. And he said, no, I've never eaten anything that's unclean, Lord. And shortly after, he receives an invitation to go to a Gentile house. Now, Jews would never go to a Gentile house. There were built into society, there were built in these nationalistic barriers. But at Pentecost, with the Holy Spirit, God's breaking those barriers down. The Tower of Babel, if you remember from Genesis, the Tower of Babel has been reversed, where instead of language separating people, God, by his Holy Spirit, is using language to bring people back together again. And so we find, here's Peter, chapter 10, verse 34. He began to speak, now I realize how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears him and does what is right. So he's shown up at the house of Cornelius, and they've invited him to speak. And so he starts doing some preaching. It's pretty good preaching. Let's check this out. You know the message God sent to the people of Israel, announcing the good news of peace through Jesus Christ, who is Lord of all. You know what happened throughout the province of Judea, beginning in Galilee, and after the baptism that John preached, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, how he went around doing good and healing all those who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. He's preaching pretty good. Yeah, go Peter. We are witnesses of everything he did in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They killed him by hanging him on the cross, but God raised him from the dead on the third day and caused him to be seen. He was not seen by all the people, but by witnesses who God had already chosen. For those of us who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead, he's preaching, he's good. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one who God anointed as judge over the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Is he preaching good? He's preaching great. And while Peter was still speaking, he doesn't even get to come to the altar call. I mean, he's preaching away, and suddenly, boom! Peter was still speaking. The Holy Spirit came on all those who heard the message. And here, where the Holy Spirit was poured out on these Jewish believers, the Holy Spirit is being poured out now on Gentiles. The Holy Spirit came on all who heard the message. The circumcised believers, those are the Jewish ones, who came with Peter, were astonished that the gift of the Holy Spirit was being poured out even on the Gentiles. But he heard them speaking in tongues and praising God. Gloria a Dieu. Or whatever they were saying. Then Peter said, surely no one can stand in the way of their being baptized with water. They have received the Holy Spirit just as we have. So he ordered that they be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. So shift number one, what was that? Power to the people. Shift number two is the gospel goes global. Now, God has been, of course, foretelling of this all throughout the Old Testament, even from his initial call to Abraham in Genesis 15. But now God is fulfilling this promise. The good news of Jesus Christ is not just good news for one people, but for all people. And so to these believers who were perhaps a little bit comfortable, a little bit entrenched in the idea that God is more on our side than he is on everybody else's, their vision of God was being greatly expanded. To say that God was concerned first of all with Israel is like saying the Allies were concerned first of all with Normandy. It wasn't all about northern France being delivered from the Nazis. It was about all of Europe. It's for all people. The gospel given through Jesus Christ, a Jew, to the Jewish nation, so that all people of every tribe, every tongue, every language, every race, every nationality could know the good news of God. Can I get an amen? Are you guys awake? Because you know who the Gentiles are? Us. We were the outsiders, and God let us in. Isn't that good? The gospel goes global and becomes large enough for you and for me and for all who call on the name of Jesus to be saved, to be delivered, to be redeemed, to be transformed, to be healed in the name of Jesus Christ. The gospel goes global. The gospel goes global. And the early church, as you've read already, the early church wrestled with this, you know. So what do we do with people that were raised differently than us that have different songs and different dress code and different ways of eating and different customs? And you saw the church remove barrier after barrier after barrier in order for the Gentiles to hear. I wonder, as the Holy Spirit continues to work in our hearts today, if he's not continuing that work in us, that we are called to especially reach out to those who are different than us, to those who don't come from the very same background, who don't look the same, who don't have the very same styles of music. The gospel is still good news for all people, everywhere. It's big enough for you. It's big enough for me. It's big enough for everyone. And the more we dive into the scriptures, the bigger we see God actually be. Oh, you need to let Jesus out of your box. You need to let the Holy Spirit out of your box, because the God of the scriptures is the one who's real, the one who speaks, the one whose spirit continues to move today. He's so much bigger than any of us have assumed. The gospel is for all people. And the power of the Holy Spirit is given to all who follow Jesus everywhere. The gospel transcends every human barrier because the Holy Spirit removes barriers. And what humanly we see as being impossible, God accomplishes. It's just like at Pentecost, as people are speaking languages they've never learned. In order that people that had not yet heard the good news of Jesus could hear it. God continues to do miracles, to transcend the barriers of men, to transcend, to go beyond the limitations of humans. God loves this world. So as we think about this message and we think about how the Holy Spirit is at work today, what are you longing for God to do in your life? What barriers are you asking for him to break down in your life and in your heart? Maybe the barriers of fear, the things that you just didn't think that you could do. Maybe the Holy Spirit is breaking down some of those barriers. Maybe the barriers between you and other people, the barriers of forgiveness or reconciliation. Our God is a God of reconciliation. And where we have built those barriers or our past experiences or our past hurts, legitimate as they may be, build up barriers, God can break them down. The barriers of shame or guilt or regret, legitimate as they may be, the power of the cross is stronger still. Jesus died, Jesus rose again, and Jesus sent his Spirit to the church, to all who would put their faith and trust in him, so that their lives could be made new. Those barriers could be broken down. What barriers are you asking God to remove in your life today? And I believe God is also moving in us corporately. What are the barriers that God is calling us to cross? What are the people groups that God is asking us to reach out to and share his love with? The gospel is good news for everyone. For everyone. For everyone. Would you bow your heads with me? And invite the worship team to come up. I don't know about you, I am just so hungry for God's work in my life. I read this book and I think, Lord, would you do this again? Lord, would you move in our time and in my life in ways with the same kind of transforming power as you moved back then? Lord, I am looking forward to the day when one little group of believers, you know, we're double the size of the crew that was gathered at Pentecost easily, would be so filled with the Spirit that thousands would come to know Jesus. I am longing for that. Are you longing for that? Call out to God just in your spirit, under your breath. Would you just ask him? God is on the move. As you're asking him for healing in your life, whether that's physical healing. Did you know that God can do that? Maybe that's relational healing. And helping the situations around you to get better. Remembering that very often as the Holy Spirit moves, it's not to make our lives easier, it's to make our hearts stronger. Lord, would you make me brave? Lord, would you make me strong? Lord, would you give me courage? I want to see you again in my life. I want to see you move in power in my life. Just lift that up to the Lord. Whatever way he's calling you, whatever you're longing for, God, would you stir a hunger in your church for your Spirit's movement among your people? Would you continue to break down barriers? Would you continue to move in places and in ways that go beyond what human beings can do? Now, maybe for somebody today, you realize that the first barrier you need to break down is the barrier between you and God. Maybe you've been keeping God at a distance. And today is your big day to respond to Jesus, to allow him to come into your life, to ask him to be your Savior and healer and Lord. If that's you, and you've been distant from God, we're not going to put you on the spot, but I would love to have an opportunity to minister to you. Can we just make eye contact for a moment? I promise I won't make you do anything weird. And I see you. It's a good day. I see you. I see you. All right. All right. All right. See, that's the Holy Spirit's moving here. He's right now. The thing that you're feeling in your heart, that's God. That's God. He's drawing you. He's drawing you back. If it's appropriate, grab the hand of somebody next to you. We got to pray for each other. We got to pray. Would you pray out loud with me? Dear God, thank you that you continue to move in power today. Lord, would you move in my life? Lord, bring healing. Lord, bring hope. Lord, bring restoration. Lord, bring boldness. Thank you that Jesus died on the cross for me. Thank you that Jesus rose again from the dead for me. I ask you to come into my life, to fill my heart, and guide me as I live for you. I pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's give God a hand. He is moving in our midst. He is moving in this world. Walls are being broken. Barriers are being taken down. And God is on the move. Would you stand and would you sing with us?